Welcome everybody to the Australian Photographic Society's 2021 Audiovisual Spring National Showcase. Many thanks to our three great judges, Bob Thomas, Jan Burt and Phil Ryan, who did an exceptionally great job in judging all of these AVs. Many thanks too to Stella Farver of the APS, who does an enormous amount of work behind the scenes for the APS as their webmaster, running their secretariat and all of those things. In this showcase today, we'll be showing nine of the AVs that were awarded either Herbert Medallions, Merits, the Bronze Medal, the Silver Medal, or the Gold Medal. I'll also list 14 acceptances that the judges had determined were really quite good, but we will not be showing those AVs today. The first of the Herbert Medallions for Best Photography goes to John Hodgson for his AV In the Wild. Congratulations, John.
Thank you.
The second Herbert Medallion for Best Original Concept goes to Anne Dakin for her AV titled The Project. Congratulations, Anne. Third Herbert Medallion and the Award of a Merit goes to Elizabeth Riley. Her Herbert Medallion is for the Best Novice Entry. What an exceptionally good performance for the first time entry. Well done, Elizabeth.
All keen photographers like to amaze their friends with their astonishing photographs. What those friends don't see is just what it takes to get the shot. It can be hard to find elbow room amongst a crowd of others who unfortunately also did their homework about the weather forecast. Sometimes you have to get low and crawl for any chance at a shot. Tour etiquette means never rocking the boat. Even if there is space to spread out, there is always someone who plonks their tripod in front of you. But just occasionally, your fellow photographers fall into place with perfect symmetry. Photographers are no strangers to undignified positions. Although, with a bit of ingenuity, one can at least keep one's clothes clean. Articulated screens have now made the stomach slither position redundant. But the squat is not necessarily easier to execute. You have to embrace the challenges: freak waves, chunks of coral battering your legs, finding the perfect angle, always where someone else is standing, and keeping other photographers out of shot. Sometimes photography is a Mexican standoff. Who drew first? Often, your subject is as interested in you as you are in it. Perhaps a little too interested for good photography. And that doesn't just go for wildlife. But it's always good to have an appreciative audience, even before you get back home. Never look away or review your images. You may miss what is right before your eyes. And never forget that there may be an even better subject behind you. But sometimes you are so immersed in the wonder of your surroundings, you don't even raise your camera.
The award of merit goes to Diana Close for her AV, Flowers at My Feet. Congratulations, Diana.
I wanted to record the beauty of flowers and realized that the variety and ephemeral beauty of the botanical world would most accurately be captured with a camera. But where and how to start? George Herbert gave me the answer. Do not wait, the time will never be just right. Start where you stand and work with whatever tools you may have at your command, and better tools will be found as you go along. As a challenge to myself, I wanted the compositions to remain true to the original specimen. I found that like the night sky with its shining stars, so too flowers shine in their juxtaposition with the dark earth. There were no rules, just trials that succeeded or failed. As Annie Leibovitz has said, nature is so powerful, so strong. Capturing its essence is not easy. Your work becomes a dance with light and the weather. It takes you to a place within yourself. Her words truly reflected what I was experiencing. My dance with light was to capture the ephemeral beauty of plants and a concern that many forces threaten their diversity. I wonder which way the pendulum will swing. Will it be towards a celebration of the beauty and wonders of nature, or a memento mori of a threatened species?
David Shetcliffe also gets a merit for his AV entitled The Mosquito. Congratulations, David.
Now a UNESCO World Heritage Site, construction of a mosque in Cordoba began in AD 785 during the Islamic occupation of parts of Spain. Expansions occurred in the 9th and 10th centuries. After King Ferdinand III recaptured Cordoba from the Moors in 1236, a Christian church was built within the mosque. Construction of a Renaissance cathedral in the centre of the mosque began in 1523 and continued for nearly 100 years. The mezquita is huge, about 1 3/4 soccer pitches, making it the largest temple in the world. It is adjacent to other ancient remains, such as the Roman Bridge, the 16th century Puerto del Ponte, and the 18th century Tower of San Rafael. Ironically, it is set in the walled Jewish quarter of Cordoba, with its narrow lanes and white walls, often decorated with flowers. Around the outside are a number of entrance gates. The bell tower is 93 metres high and replaced the former minaret of the mosque, which was severely damaged by a storm and earthquake in 1589. Before entering the mosque, the faithful washed in the courtyard of the orange trees. Inside the mosque are 856 aesthetic columns, made of marble, granite, jasper, and other minerals. Maintenance and repairs are constantly carried out. The carved wooden ceiling preserves the original style, while later high ceilings reflect the Christian influence. The mihrab, or Islamic prayer room, has rich mosaics. The first Christian chapel was built in 1371. A number of Christian vaults have been constructed, and Christian icons have been incorporated into parts of the former mosque. The Capilla Mayor is the main cathedral. The red marble main altar was finished in 1653. It consists of a central tabernacle and paintings by Antonio Palomino. The choir stalls, carved out of mahogany wood, comprise 23 lower seats and 30 upper seats. The large episcopal throne centrepiece features a life-size representation of the Ascension of Jesus. The organ has pipes on both sides of the nave. The carved mahogany pulpit and other carvings are found throughout the cathedral. The treasure chamber contains many pieces, including the gold monstrance manufactured by German goldsmith Heinrich von Aff in 1510 to 1516. The Mosquito, a wonderfully rich reflection of history.
Anne Pappalardo gets a merit for her AV titled Puffin Love. Well done, Anne.
Scoma Island in Wales is a well-known haven for puffins. I had the opportunity to photograph these delightful birds over 2 days at the end of their mating season. Their antics are quite humanesque, and I did not expect to be so beguiled by these creatures. I fell in love with their behaviour and their personalities. They are demonstrative and loving, family-focused, and at times quite funny to watch. They are, quite literally, the most endearing of birds.
We now present the three medal winners. The first of these is the bronze medal going to Wal Close for his AV, Miho, a design masterpiece. Congratulations, Wal.
In the mountains southeast of Kyoto is the Miho Museum. Behind me is the large car park, bus terminal, and reception center. The way forward is through the elegant and understated gateway. The path is inviting, but there is no destination in sight. The museum is in the next valley. Around the first curve, I find myself in a quiet, relaxing environment and see the electric coach for visitors who find the steepness difficult. Around the next curve is the unexpected appearance of a tunnel entrance. The tunnel is a contrast to the more natural beauty of the pathway. It is remarkably quiet inside, and that is the effect of the sound-absorbing titanium panels. The curve blocks the image of the destination, and I become captured by the tunnel's beauty. The entrance to the museum is revealed towards the end of the curve. Typically, the view is off-center. A suspension bridge leads onto a plaza before the steps to the entrance. The circle of glass in the doorway frames a typical Japanese scene. Everywhere inside, exposure reveals the precision of design and construction. Views of the outside enhance the experience. This very old tree was specially selected and brought on site. As I exit the museum, I see more beautifully arranged views. Even the service tunnel and its surrounds are attractive. Most of the museum is underground, and the hill and its forest were removed for construction and then replaced exactly as they were. Crossing the valley via the bridge and re-entering the tunnel is no anticlimax. As I reach the path to the exit, I know that I have visited a masterpiece.
The silver medal goes to Adrian Weir and myself. All the photographs in this AV were taken by Adrian, who is an exceptional street photographer, and I'm privileged to have been able to work with him. We had a great time putting this together. Congratulations, Adrian.
We'll be right back.
And at the very top is the gold medal winner, Humpback Highway, produced by Sally Hinton. Sally also gets the Herbert Medallion for Best Script. Congratulations, Sally, on a fantastic AV.
Each winter, humpback whales undergo a 10,000-kilometre migration up Australia's eastern coastline, which becomes the Humpback Highway. They migrate north from their nutrient-rich feeding grounds in Antarctica to the warm water of the Great Barrier Reef to give birth, mate and socialise. This northern current is about 100 kilometres wide and passes my home along the Tweed Coast. The size of a bus, these huge marine mammals, are inspirational as they swim effortlessly through the water. They are expressive, dynamic, and epic navigators of the sea. Pure elegance underwater. A calf weighs about a ton at birth, but is tiny and vulnerable compared to its 40-ton parent. When born, it has very little blubber, so would not survive in the icy waters of the Antarctic, hence the need to be born in warmer climes. It will suckle up to 600 litres of milk a day until weaned. This milk is high fat and protein, which allows the calf to grow rapidly and to develop sufficient blubber to survive the migration back to the cold waters of the Southern Ocean. The mother and calf usually have an escort, a large male to protect them for the rest of their journey. Hence, you will often see pods of three, two large adults, and a baby or juvenile. Humpbacks breathe through two blowholes on the top of their head. As they rise to the surface, they blow water 3 to 5 meters into the air. It is a beautiful sound and indicates that a humpback is near. Spy hopping is when they poke their heads above the water, just to have a peek. Who is watching who, I wonder? Their tail is called a fluke. It is the powerhouse of the whale and can be up to 5.5 meters wide. The underside of the fluke is used to identify individuals. This is their fingerprint. Tail slapping or lobtailing is when they use the peduncle muscle to slap their flukes powerfully onto the water. No one really knows why they do this, but the sound can carry for kilometres. The iconic breech. Powered by 2 to 3 thumps of the tail, these massive creatures can launch themselves out of the water again and again. It is not known if it is for fun and exuberance, or if it serves another social purpose. The resulting belly flops can be heard for many kilometres. Humpbacks have huge wing-like flippers called pectoral fins, which give them excellent control and manoeuvrability, and enable them to do underwater loops and turns. With their pectoral fins outstretched, they appear to glide through the water with elegance and grace. It is not known why they slapped them onto the water. Is it for attracting attention or simple relaxation? It is sad to think that these beautiful creatures were almost hunted to extinction. In 1963, the humpbacks along the Australian east coast had been reduced to about 100. Now, with protection, the recovery of this humpback population has increased to between 30 and 40,000, and increasing every year. They have made their way back from the brink of extinction to become a global conservation success story. So the lesson is obvious. Wildlife and nature can bounce back if it is just given a chance. And hopefully, future generations can continue to enjoy the antics of these exuberant giants of the sea as they navigate along their humpback highway.
Now we move on to a list of the acceptances. The first of these is a bit of a twisted fairy story titled What Chelsea Wants by Rocco Sempaglione and myself. Cynthia Henley-Smith has produced the AV titled Annie's Diary, which tells the story of Annie, one of Cynthia's ancestors, when she came to settle in Australia and the hardships that she faced. Anne Dakin has produced A Journey Back in Time, an interesting AV about Captain Cook's cottage in the Fitzroy Gardens in Melbourne. Oude Kerk is the story of the oldest building in Amsterdam, which is a church, produced by Wal Close. John Quixley has produced an AV of his hometown with the postcode 4017, using painterly effects. Graham Phillips has produced the AV Ikara Country, about a beautiful region of Australia. Harmony in China, produced by both John Hodgson and Judith Hodgson, is about the story of a choral group touring China. Let There Be Light is an AV produced by John Hodgson about light, sunlight and beautiful landscapes. Queen Mary is an AV produced by Cynthia Henley-Smith about the Queen Mary, the ship currently located in Los Angeles. Red Sky, Red Sand by Ruth Goldwasser is an AV about, again, the sky and sand and redness of the Australian outback. Clouds by Bernd Langos is an interesting AV documenting clouds, the formation of clouds and so on. Australia Home by Ruth Goldwasser is an interesting AV about Australia. Church on the Rise by Cynthia Henley-Smith is about a church in her hometown and the history of that church. Sparkles by Graham Phillips is an AV about the Docklands area of Melbourne. That concludes the showcase for today. Thank you all for attending, and thank you to everybody who submitted entries for this fabulous contest.